Good evening.
Good evening.
And welcome to the Institute of Divine Metaphysical Research. This is a school and not a church, and neither are we affiliated with any religious organization. This school is a non... I forgot to put the mic on.
It's the heat. It's a fire here.
You forgot the mic.
No, on the mic.
Even though he has a loud voice.
Yeah.
Testing. Good evening.
Good evening.
And welcome to the Institute of Divine Metaphysical Research. This is a school and not a church, and neither are we affiliated with any religious organization. This school is a non-profit, non-denominational, religious, and scientific research organization dedicated to showing proof of the existence of Yahweh or Elohim and the operation of His eternal purpose, pattern, and plan operating throughout eternity and to this present day. This school was established as a result of a divine vision and revelations given to our founder, Dr. Henry Clifford Tinley, in the state of Ohio in the year of 1931. We were incorporated into the state of California in the year of 1958. Since that time, we have established branch schools throughout the United States and Canada and certain foreign countries. The Ontario branch was established in May of 1988. Now in this school, we teach by the true and correct names and titles for the Father, the Word, our Son, and the Holy Spirit as contained in the original Hebrew text. The true and correct name for the Father is Yahweh. It has been improperly substituted by Lord. The true title for the Word or Son is Elohim. It has been improperly substituted by God. The name of the Holy Spirit, manifest in or out of a physical body, is Yahshua. It has been improperly substituted by Jesus Christ. Lord and God are titles and not names. The Apostle Paul, filled with the Holy Spirit, tells us in 1 Corinthians 8 and 5, that there are Lord's many and God's many. But we now know each Lord must have a name and each God must have a name also. Elohim is a title. But unlike Lord and God, Elohim is a divine title. This means that Elohim is the title that our Creator chose for Himself. Jesus is a name, but it is an erroneous name. A minor investigation on your part into a good dictionary or encyclopedia will prove that neither the Hebrew language, the Greek language, nor the Latin language have any letters or characters in their alphabet that will produce the sound that is made by this letter J. Neither was there a letter J in the English language for some 1400 years after the Messiah's death. Therefore, such names as Jesus and Jehovah are impossible renderings for the true and correct name of our Father and His Son. Christ is a title just like Lord and God. Now, Yahweh is pure spirit, and in this state, He is inscrutable and incomprehensible and indiscernible. He is the ultimate source, substance, limits, and bounds of all things. We have Yahweh in His pure spirit state, symbolized on this chart as a fiery cloud. Yahweh in pure spirit is not a cloud. He merely chose the cloud to symbolize Himself, because a cloud has no particular or descriptive shape and form. Just as you see, this fiery cloud has been drawn to extend all around the edge of this chart to show you that everything on this chart abides within this cloud. Just as everything in the creation and the sum total of the universe abides within this pure spirit state of Yahweh. Yahweh, knowing that man cannot perceive of him in this pure spirit state, took on shape and form within himself as Elohim. This is the Word, our Son, a super incorporeal being, that is, having the shape and form of a man, but without flesh and blood. This form can only be seen in divine visions and understood in divine revelations. Later on, this self-same spirit manifested himself in a physical body and walked the earth plane as Yahshua the Messiah, whom the world calls Jesus Christ. Now, there's only one name given unto salvation, and we must know that name. So the simple yet intelligent question we should ask ourselves is, what was the name of the Savior during the time he walked the earth plane? A further understanding of this name and title may be had by reading the preface to the Holy Name Bible. Also in this school, we teach by the divine pattern of the universe. It is called a divine pattern because it is Yahweh's pattern. After Yahweh led the children of Israel out of Egypt, he called Moses atop Mount Sinai and showed him the tabernacle pattern in a vision. He instructed Moses to build one exactly like it in the wilderness of Sinai. This pattern consists of a most holy place, a holy place, and a court roundabout. These three compartments make up the one tabernacle pattern. We go forth in this school to show proof how that everything in the universe is made and operates according to the structure and function of this threefold tabernacle pattern, and that absolutely nothing escapes the pattern. The primary constitutional aims and objectives of the Institute are as follows. First is to help you find and know Yahweh, our Elohim, as he really is and actually exists. Second is to form a nucleus of universal brotherhood of humanity in Yahshua the Messiah without distinction of race or nationality, creed, sex, caste, or color. Third is to investigate the unexplained spirit law of the so-called laws of nature and the powers latent in man. Fourth is to encourage and promote the study of the scriptures, comparative religions, psychology, philosophy, and modern practical and occult science. Fifth is to extirpate current superstition, skepticism, and ignorance. Sixth is to learn, know, and understand the operation of Yahweh's eternal purpose through the dispensations and ages. Seventh is to discern and avoid being deceived by Lucifer, the serpent, the devil, the dragon, or Satan and his demons operating a mystery of iniquity on earth through the dispensations of time. Eighth is to earnestly contend for the common salvation and faith which was once delivered unto the sons, our children of Yahweh. Ninth is to make known that Yahweh, from the beginning, ordained there is no other name given among men whereby a man can be saved, save in the name of Yahshua the Messiah. And tenth is to inherit eternal life now in the kingdom of Yahshua the Messiah with the hope of immortal glorification in the new earth state. Our watchword is peace, and our slogan is speak the truth. We'll have a prayer this evening by Dr. Iggy Ramirez, and we'll have a scripture lesson of John, the second chapter, by Dr. Boyd Munch.
Let's all bow our hearts. Oh, Yahweh Elohim, we ask that you bless us tonight, and we ask that you give us strength and power to deal with the things of everyday life in this flesh as we go on to learn and seek more about you and let the Holy Spirit grow in us all. All this we ask in your holy name. Hallelujah.
Hallelujah. Good evening, class.
Good evening.
Tonight's scripture will be taken from the book of John, the second chapter, and I'll be reading to you from the Holy Name Bible. This Bible was critically compared with ancient authorities and various manuscripts and revised by the late A.B. Traina. He happened to be an Italian Jew, and he was with the Scripture Research Association Incorporated. John 2. And the third day, there was a marriage in Cana of Galilee, and the mother of Yahshua was there. And both Yahshua and his disciples were called to the marriage. And when they wanted wine, the mother of Yahshua saith unto him, they have no wine. Yahshua saith unto her, woman, what have I to do with thee? Mine hour is not yet come. His mother saith unto the servants, whatsoever he saith unto you, do it. And there were set there 6 water pots of stone, after the manner of the purifying of the Jews, containing 2 or 3 firkins apiece, 20 or 30 gallons. Yahshua saith unto them, fill the water pots with water. And they filled them up to the brim. And he saith unto them, draw out now, and bear unto the governor of the feast. And they bear it. And when the ruler of the feast had tasted the water that was made into wine, and knew not whence it was, but the servants which drew the water knew, the kingdom of the feast called the bridegroom, and saith unto him, every man at the beginning doth set forth good wine, and when men have well drunk, then that which is worse. But thou hast kept the good wine until now. This beginning of miracles did Yahshua in Canaan of Galilee, and manifested forth his power, and his disciples believed on him. After this, he went down to Capernaum, he and his mother and his brethren, and his disciples, and they continued there not many days. And when the Passover was at hand, Yahshua went up to Jerusalem. And found in the temple there those that sold oxen and sheep and doves and the changers of money sitting. And when he had made a scourge of small cords, he drove them all out of the temple, and the sheep and the oxen, and poured out the changers' money and overthrew the tables. And he said unto them that sold doves, take these things hence, make not my Father's house a house of merchandise. And his disciples remembered that it was written, the zeal for thine house hath eaten me up. Then answered the Jews and said unto him, what sign showest thou unto us, seeing that thou doest these things? Yahshua answered and said unto them, destroy this temple, and in 3 days I will raise it up. Then the Jews said, 46 years was this temple in the building, and wilt thou rear it up in 3 days? But he spake of the temple of his body. When therefore he was risen from the dead, his disciples remembered that he had said this unto them. And they believed the scripture and the word which Yahshua had said. Now when he was in Jerusalem at the Passover in the feast day, many believed in his name when they saw the miracles which he did. But Yahshua did not trust himself unto them, because he knew all men, and needed not that any should testify of the nature of man, for he knew what was in man's nature. John, the second chapter.
Hallelujah. Would anybody like to have anything to say this evening? Okay, our first speaker will be Dr. Bud Wong.
Okay. I wanted to bounce a question off the class, but that's fine. I'll do it from here. Where's Will when we need him?
Work, school.
Will.
That work or school?
Oh, okay. I suck. Okay, read this carefully and tell me how this can be. Starts out, he changes the water into wine, right? Mm-hmm. So that's the first wine that they have at this wedding, right? Mm-hmm. And yet, the governor of the feast called the bridegroom and said it unto him, every man at the beginning doth set forth good wine, and when men have well drunk, then that which is worse. But thou hast kept the good wine until now. Something is left out or something that doesn't make sense to me.
Well,
it sounds like he's saying, this was the only wine they had, and now the governor is saying, the stuff that you gave us before wasn't as good as this.
Well, first thing you got to ask is, what's the Messiah doing?
Well, a miracle showing his
power. I mean, what's he doing in the whole sense of the...
Fulfilling.
He's fulfilling.
Okay.
The next thing is to say, is ask is, what is he fulfilling? Now that, I don't know.
Okay.
We have to go back in the law and the prophets to see something of that nature. And then when he says, the next of the, at the last, he goes, tear this temple down in 3 days and I shall raise it up again.
Yeah.
That's also has to be proven in the law and the prophets, because whatever he's saying, whatever he's doing, he's fulfilling. That's what we got to keep in mind. But as far as the wine, well, when he changed the water to wine, the governor was so impressed with it because it was the best wine he ever had. Mm-hmm. And the parties that he went to before, is people, they bring out the best stuff first. Mm-hmm. Then when they're drunk, they bring out the bad stuff. They don't want to waste the good stuff on a bunch of drunks.
Right.
You know, but this was made out of water. And it was the best wine this guy ever had, you know. This governor, you know, and he says, "This is the why did you bring out the best wine at the last?" You know,
but they hadn't had any wine prior to that at this wedding.
Well, if you read at the beginning,
read
at the beginning when the Messiah's mother, you know, start all over again.
Okay, the third day was marriage in Canaan of Galilee, and the mother of Joshua was there. Both Joshua and his disciples were called to the marriage, and when they wanted wine, the mother of Joshua saith unto him, they have no wine.
Mm-hmm. They finish him.
They what?
They ended with the wine.
They were done with the first batch.
Drunk all the wine.
Oh, so there had been some served before?
Yeah, drinking all.
Yeah, they had drunk all.
Okay. All right.
Yeah, I
didn't, when it said they have no wine, I didn't realize that they had run out of wine.
Yeah, they're at a party.
I thought they didn't have wine from the start. Okay, that makes sense. Thank you. Okay.
He made no good problem. Wine.
What's that?
So when he made the wine out of the water, that was good.
Yeah.
That was like the second wine.
Yeah.
And he wanted to know, why would you give the second wine after people done already drunk the wine?
Yeah.
You know.
Yeah. Okay.
Well. But it's something in its purpose, you know, we have to look at. But that's to say, whatever he's doing, he's fulfilling, you know, so.
Yeah, and what you say makes a lot of sense. Mm-hmm. So, with those few questions, I will take my seat.
Okay. Thank you.
In a timely fashion.
Our next speaker this evening will be Dr. Samuel Salas.
Well, good evening, class.
Good evening.
It's a pleasure to stand before you and testify some of the things I learned in all this time since I started coming to IDMR. Mm-hmm. I have a lot of things in my mind, but one in particular I've been thinking, like, you know, I am searching for any little thing we don't know about the tabernacle. And I mean, I see something I never seen before, shaken into. See, this tabernacle, as you know, is a figure of heavenly things.
That's right. Mm-hmm.
So this is why we have to have it, check it meticulously because maybe whatever you find there might have something spiritual meaning. And this tabernacle have the most holy place in Coronaval. Mm-hmm. And we know this tabernacle match the physical body. Mm-hmm. The physical body breaking into three parts, head cavity, chest cavity, and abdominal cavity. And we all know, we've been saying this for so many years, this tabernacle match this one or vice versa. This one match this one. Mm-hmm. However you want to look it up. This is so mysteriously the way it works, how the priest going into once a year and the atonement, when they make three sacrifices. The high priest have a place to go into the most holy place three times. One time, they sacrificed the bull, which was the first sacrifice. Mm-hmm. They went into there and sprinkled the blood and the curtains of the most holy place. The same thing with the ram. Mm-hmm. He went over and sprinkled the curtain inside the most holy place. And when he sacrificed the lamb, that was, I can say, was the most important thing of the three sacrifices. Because the last sacrifice was a lamb. And everything you look into is about the lamb. Or the sacrifice. The lamb. Or the sacrifice of the lamb. Eventually, we ended with the sacrifice of Yahshua the Messiah, which was the last sacrifice, so it's in the temple, once a year. But only one door, or I cannot call door, one passage to go into the most holy place, because it was 18 inches wide, 1 cubit. There is boards around the holy place and the most holy place of acacia, covered by gold, not just wood, no, covered by gold. There was 6 boards right here and 6 boards in there of 1 cubit and a half each. That means 9 cubits. But the dimension is 10 cubits. 1 cubit missing. So the cubit is missing is where the high priest go into there. But this is the mystery I just found. So it's here. I don't know where here or there. There was an opening also. Here or there. Because also there were 6 boards of 1 cubit and a half. Total 9 cubits. And the dimension is 10 cubits. 10 by 10 and 20 by 10. In other words, 30 by 10. See, I never heard about this opening in there, there or there. But it had to be an opening. Otherwise, they could say the dimensions fill or completely cover this area. Well, this is a no one had the authority to go into, because this tabernacle, the holy place, the most holy place, it was The dimensions here are not looking perfectly, but let me make a picture of. This is a figure of the tabernacle. This is 100 cubits, and this is 50 cubits. This is 30, and this is 10. This is 10, and 10, 10. This is a missing, or one cubit had to be there or had to be there. But nobody's supposed to go in there, just the high priest once a year. He can go here, but not there. They did the works, and the court run about, and the holy place, but not in the most holy place, only once a year. Now, every day, a cloud, like smoke, was coming out of there. Even if that was covered, even if it was that covered, we have a cloud showing the Spirit of Yahweh was operating there. When this cloud moves someplace else or moving from there and goes somewhere else and keep going, they knew was a time to dismantle the tabernacle and the three tribes, descendant of Levi, her son, Kohath, and Merari, they had to put things together and start walking with all those things. Kohath is the one who held all the gold, silver things, or precious things. And the other two sons, her son and Merari, they had the curtains and other items in there. But one was impressed or thinking, why an opening here? There is no place, the Bible says, was an opening there. See, this is the way the tabernacle is this is 1.5 cubit. How many boards? 20 boards? 20? 20? 10? 30? 30? 10? 10? 10? There is no boards in here. Columns, holes. Now, the boards in here were the total two boards like this. One, two, three, four. 5, 6, 7, 8. I check in tabernacle. This is the way they are. It's not showing here. But I don't know where I'm going with this thing. But this opening here is a mystery for me. Might be a reason for it. I don't know. The only thing I investigate is what we all have to do. To investigate anything we hear, anything we read, that way when we say something, we know for a fact we have the truth. Even searching and all those things, also we can fail that way too. So we have to ask our Heavenly Father to give us the right answers and the right directions, that we can, that way we can give away this teaching in the right way. Like I've been listening and I put attention and I never went to sleep because everything has been seen here is very interesting for me. And I when I hear something I never hear before, I check it. I don't check the whole thing, but I keep my ears and my eyes open most of the time. And well, changing this about this tabernacle, let me go to something else. There's only three things Yahweh gave a specify how to build. Mm-hmm. Noah's Ark, the tabernacle, we say Moses' tabernacle, because it was revealed to him how to build. Mm-hmm. He was given the blueprint. He was given the blueprint how to construct. Mm-hmm. And he have the right person. Yahweh pick up two persons to help him. Mm-hmm. One was Bezalel, and the other one was Oliab. Yahweh give them so much knowledge and wisdom how to work with gold and silver and linen. So they come up with this perfectly tabernacle. Never was built one before. But there was something, I don't see copy from other civilization, because Yahweh no copy nothing from that, from nowhere.
That's right.
Excuse me, let me have a little water. I've been drinking so much water all day. I don't know why I'm not this big. I drink gallons and gallons. Watermelon, whatever is available is fresh. To see, Yahweh never copied nothing from nobody. He made the whole thing himself. Mm-hmm. There is nothing exists, visible or invisible, it was not made from him. Or he didn't make. But it was in Egypt, who was one of the first civilizations in the ancient times. There were few. It was the Assyrian, it was the Persian, Persian, and also was the Babylonian. Babylonian first, Assyrian, and Persian, and the Egyptians. In Egypt, there is one I can say monument. Mm-hmm. Looks like a lion.
Sphinx.
A sphinx, they call it. And this one, the tabernacle, have something in common with that. The tabernacle, the Hebrew, the 12 tribes of Israel, they divide into 12 Yahweh's mysteries. How this was built before Moses built this one. But remember, Yahweh Elohim, Yahweh transformed, by transmutation became Elohim.
That's right.
And Elohim transformed into a threefold unchangeable sanctuary, a tabernacle. So this one was before the Sphinx. We can say, you cannot see the four flags, but the angelical host, I cannot prove because they're not in the Bible. But they were divided also. There. Like the men. 1, 2, 3. 1, 2, 3. 1, 2, 3. Make 12. And those 12 parts of the extremities guide us through the day. And those four flags or those 12 tribes move this tabernacle every time they have to move. But this tabernacle, there is no question about was before the Sphinx. This was and already exist in the realm of eternity. But you see the other way, this was made before this one. But that's incorrect. Because I explained you. This was created on the realm of eternity. And this became to exist after Adam and Eve, probably 1,000 years later. See, there is one way. The founder told us how to introduce this teaching. The way he did it was the correct time, the correct way. All the time he started with Moses. When he was a little baby, he was thrown in the Nile River, and he was drowned out from there, and the Pharaoh's sister gave him act like his mother. She put him in college, gave him a good education. There was a purpose for Moses. He was Yahweh's purpose. Moses, he was well educated, but for certain reasons, you know, he had to go out of Egypt. He had to run for his life because he slew an Egyptian. So he was 40 years that time. He went away. He came back after another 40 years. So he was 80 years old when Yahweh called him. Moses, he went on a top of a mountain. In reality, he went 5 times into a mountain. But he went 3 times when he came out of Egypt. He went the first time and he was given the law. The second time he took Yeshua with him, or he went with Yahshua. So he went by himself the 3rd time. But before that, he went on top of the mountain and he was told to go and deliver the Hebrews, his brother, from bondage. He is when he see the burning bush. Moses, take your sandal out of your feet because the ground where you are standing is a holy ground. So he did so. You see right there. So he see an angel and he received all the instructions how to do it. And he went back into Egypt. He put a lot of excuses. I don't have a good way to speak or communicate. Don't worry, your brother Aaron is going to meet you in the way and everything else will be okay. Mm-hmm. Oh, but I don't qualify. Why you take me? Give me this job. Oh, Moses, listen, put your hand. And Boston, he did so. Take him out. And see leprosy. Leprosy in that time was one of the most dangerous disease in the time.
That's right.
Because it was not easy to wash the body because there was not so much water in there. The river, Jordan River, but they were most of the time in the desert with not too much water. So that disease, leprosy, whoever have a leprosy, everybody run away from him. They have a disease.
That's right.
Especially for those people. Nobody, just people go and deliver the food and just try to wash their hands and have a shower and they don't want to be contaminated with them. So when he sees his hand, he says, I put it back. He take him out, he was clean. He knew was a power in there. Moses, throw your rod to the floor. Turned to a serpent, isn't it?
Mm-hmm.
And he picked it up. Mm-hmm. With all that confidence, he said, well, the Almighty is in my side, the Al Shaddai. Because that time he didn't know his name was Yahweh. The name was not revealed yet to him. So he went over to Egypt and told the Pharaoh, leave my brothers free, that way we can worship our Elohim outside. So here the Pharaoh refused 9 times, in total he refused 10, but I say 9, because the last, it was very important. The last was the most dangerous one. Whoever do not have the blood of the Lamb in the doors,
right,
they will be the firstborn, die, the firstborn. So everybody was obedient. And they slew a lamb, and the lamb also had to be without spot and blemish. Not only here, also there.
That's right.
Because it was the resemblance of that one, the one they sacrificed here, and this one. So when they did so, they were saved, nobody died. But the Egyptian, they were not told to do so. So they went into their business like another regular day. And Moses told him, hey, deliver my brothers for the 10th time. No, no, I won't do that. So that night, an angel came and slew the firstborn. Not only of the people, also the animals, mm-hmm. Ducks, horses, whatever, dogs, any animal, beast, the firstborn also died. After that, Pharaoh's heart was softened. And I said, get out of here the fastest you can. The reason why he said that, because Pharaoh's son died in the process, because he had one son, and that son passed away. And Pharaoh tried to request his idols, his gods he had, to give his life to his son. But they were idols of stone or gold or whatever. No life in them. So they don't do anything. When the children of Israel went away, they have everything they can grab, whatever they belong. Horses, donkeys, jewelry, clothes, anything they have, goats, they took with them. They went into the desert. Can you imagine all the dust they put in the air? Man, they went fast, the fastest they can. Children, women, old people, and young men. But after 3 days, Pharaoh's heart started to get hard. And he told his soldiers, get ready. Go and chase those Hebrews and kill them. I want all to be killed. We send his best chariots, his best soldiers, with the best horses, the fastest one. 600 chariots, 600 soldiers, and 600 horses. 666. As we all know, the name of the beast, 603 plus 6, mm-hmm. The number of men.
Yes. Right.
Revelation 13:18. And Pharaoh's host, they tried to kill all the Hebrews. And Moses walked by the sea. Where is the? We don't have a map. Oh, right here. Right here. They were right somewhere here. And Pharaoh's coming And the water was in front of them. He said, "Oh, Moses, why you bring us over here to be killed?" Mm-hmm. "Oh, yes, surrender. Let's say sorry. We can go back and start working." "No, no, 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 no." And he put the rod up, and the waters of the Red Sea opened. And all the children went in there, crossed to the other side. The census was made after they crossed the Red Sea, 2 years after. It was 603,550. They were counted 2 years after they crossed the Red Sea. That's the first census they had. But only the men ready for war, young from 20, those people, they were counted the first time right there after they come out of Egypt, because they were counted before. When Joseph family went into Egypt, they were only 70 souls. They multiply so much, the Egyptians, they thought they multiplied like rabbits. Mm-hmm. Pretty soon they probably take over the kingdom and another kingdom make war with us. They can align with them and control us. Mm-hmm. They probably take a revenge for what we, the way we treat them. So we don't want that. So this is why when Solomon and Moses' time, they kill all the little boys. They wanna. They don't want. They multiply no more, as fast they were doing. The second census, after coming out of Egypt, was before going into the Promised Land. Before going into the Promised Land, they count. Moses say, make a census. 601,730 souls. Men ready for war. Mm-hmm. Not counting the old, young women. Mm-hmm. The Yahweh told them not to count them no more.
Right, that's right.
And years went by, too many years went by. David, Saul was a king. David was the second king. And he didn't trust Yahweh because the Philistines, they were numerous, very good warriors. They were enemies of the Hebrews. He said, "Oh, I wonder how many soldiers I have available to fight those Philistines." And he told his soldiers, "Hey, count me the people, the men available for war." Oh, he probably forgot. He was. They were told not to count no more. Oh, I'm not sure. He probably remembered, but he didn't trust Yahweh. He count 500,000 Israelites, and he count 800,000 of Judah, with the other one, Ephraim. So total 1,300,000. Million 300, 1, 2, 3. David was punished for that.
Mm-hmm.
Yahweh didn't like the disobedience of David. But one of these prophets tell David, I want to punish him, but I want he choose from three. 3 months, they want to chase him. If they find him, they kill him. Or 7 years, drought, no water, no rain, no water. Or 3 days, pestilence. He go for the, according to him, the too easy one. Oh, 3 days, that's nothing. 70,000 people died for the disobedience. See what happened? David he was a good man. He disobeyed. He was punished for that. He himself was not punished physically, but the soldiers or the people he ruled,
right. They
paid for his disobedience. And another time, also the Hebrews, they were counted too. They were counted when they come out of Persia. They were taken prisoners to Babylon by Nabucodonosor. They took them, and the Persian king defeated the Babylonians. The Babylonians, they didn't put a resistance. They just opened the doors of Babylon because they know they were not match for the Persians. They said, okay, take the kingdom. This is the way the fight that was taken, Babylon. When the Persians had all the prisoners, Hebrew prisoners, Babylonia had, Jeremiah already said, they will be in bondage 70 years. After those 70 years, they will return and rebuild the temple. And that happened. Before the 70 years, the king of Persia allowed them to go and build the temple because he see so many miracles they did. And they were very good people. Only the first wave, 49,847 souls returned from total. From 1,300,000. This was the first wave. Later on, more returned. But what they did, they started rebuilding the temple again. But the people, they were left behind. And people not know how to read and write, or only people work good for work in the farm, mm-hmm. with no knowledge, no. So they married to another people, not tribes, because the Persian, the Babylonians, they first, the Assyrians, bring other races and mix with them. And at the same time, the Assyrians lose the war to the Babylonians. This is something you have to, you like history, you get to read how this was developed, or how this became. Let me, this is, a lot of things I is telling you by I did by reading, and other things I by listening to the speakers. But see, the Assyrians, let me make the map. This was a Roman, Greece, Turkey, Israel, Egypt, France, Spain, okay, the Assyrians, they were right here, Assyrians. Babylonians, right here. Nineveh, capital. Babylon, right here. They were very close. Persians. Now is the country of Iran. See, Assyrians, they took over Israel, all the 10 tribes, and they went, they took everywhere, lost forever. The Judah, they remained close to 100 years before they were taken to Babylon. And after they were taken to Babylon, those same people were was taken to Iran or Persia. From Persia, they come back and rebuild the temple. Took 70 years in exile after they were taken from Babylon. See, the Roman Empire, almost all, they control all this. When Yahshua the Messiah what came and fulfilled the law, the prophet, they had the north of Africa, most of Europe, and Asia Minor. They were the Roman Empire one time. See, this is the way, first the Assyrians, then the Babylonians, then the Persians, they come back and rebuild the temple. But they, when they rebuild the temple, they didn't have this Ark of the Covenant. Why? Because Nabucodonosor, they make like in writing, when you count things, every little item, how you call it? Census? No. When they count every single item in one store to make, every year they make for taxes. How you, they call
audit.
It?
An audit.
Yeah. How you?
Audit.
Yeah. So, there is no writings in the Babylonians' books because they have tablets already writings what they took from the temple, and they don't mention the Ark of the Covenant. They mention this, those were returned by the Persians, but not this one because they were not available. They didn't have. They disappeared when Babylonians ransacked the temple. They were lost. This way, they rebuilt the temple, but they didn't have that. That was in the year 586, when was ransacked the temple. When Yahshua the Messiah came, they didn't have the Ark of the Commandment in the temple. They didn't have this. They were doing the worship, they were doing things, but they didn't have the Ark. Later on, when the Romans take over, because this temple was rebuilt bigger, when they come, they come from Persia, they rebuild, but Herodes the Great make it more splendors, a bigger standard, but they don't have. They are of the covenant with them. When the Romans finally went over and into this temple, they were full of people defending. That was the last stronghold for the Hebrews to defend. It took days for the Romans to go into. He would die defending the most sacred place of worship. When the Roman captain went into the most holy place, he only see an empty room and nothing there. See, I like history. History is something you can relate, if it's true or it's not. You can relate with an investigation, like it was telling my good brother, Reginald Thomas. I'm doing my walk every day. And there's a store, 7-Eleven, and I meet a guy, a young guy, probably 25 years old. And I start to talk to him about Yahweh and the names and different things. Oh yeah, oh, makes sense. And I told him, for the first time, I found in those many years I've been telling people the little knowledge I have, I found somebody listen the way you listen. I never find nobody before. I am so happy, you see. And let me bring you something you can read from my school. And okay. Well, you say, I'm going Sunday to visit you in your house after class, okay? I meet you 2 o'clock Sunday. Mm-hmm. He didn't show up, I was waiting there. The next few days later, I went over there, my walk, and I found him. And I gave the aims, and I gave the introduction of the school, and I showed him, and as soon as he started reading, everything changed his mind. It was completely different. It was a defense, like unbelievable how he changed when he sees something written explaining him the moderation. Mm-hmm. You don't want to hear no more about that. Wow. And I know what it is. I know what it is. Mm-hmm. I know why too. But we know. We are in the right place. Even if we cannot articulate and give the good introduction and win explanation, about this vision and revelation the founder had. If you just try your best, just give away what you have, what you've been learning, and this Yahweh's looking at you 24 hours a day. He knew how sincere you are. And I don't say this is appointment, but I was telling Richard and Thomas how happy I am. I found a personal lesson about the school. But a few days later, I said, what happened? You know that. He probably went over and tell his reverend. Mm-hmm. Yeah. And he probably say, oh, don't listen to him. He's the devil. I don't say it that happened that way, but he was in guard, and he was like, he don't want to hit no more. So but I explained about the names. It's, you cannot contradict, it's impossible. That's the first thing I do. When I try to explain something about the gospel, I go by the names, easy, I don't push it. I say I use the correct name of our Heavenly Father, and it's Yahweh. They say, oh yeah, I hear about before. Yeah. See, but we are in other times, and we are in another country, we are not Hebrews. Yeah, I say, listen. The name of Yahweh is universal. There is no borders for him. Mexico, United States, Canada, or Guatemala. No. It's one name, universal for everyone.
That's right.
You say, well, but I cannot, somebody cannot say, like, what is your name? My name is, in Spanish, is Samuel. See? But here is Samuel. No, I say. They call me Samuel.
There you go.
But my name is still Samuel. Mm-hmm. Even if they cannot say my name correctly, they try, they might say Samuel, something mm-hmm. like that. But look, have a similarity. Look like the way they pronounce some words, sometimes it's impossible. Mm-hmm. Even in the Hebrew people, there were 12 tribes. They did not speak exactly like the other one. Every tribe speak a little different than the other one because they never mix. So they have accent. One time, one of the tribes living the other side of the river, they were again the Judah people. But they tried to cross the river and they say, hey, say this. When they cannot say the word correctly, they knew we're enemy. See, this is the way they spy. They were spies. Sometimes the Hebrews, they fight each other. Many times, the Israelites and the Judah, they fight continuously. But they never have the ultimatum or the war for totally destruction. Mm-hmm. One time they were ready. But one of the prophets said, no, Yahweh said, not to have this war. Yes, live alone and yes, try to live in peace. That happened when Israel and Judah were divided. After Solomon died, they split. We are going into the names. And I say, Yahweh is the correct name because listen, we glorify the name of our Creator. Being conscious or not being conscious, knowing or not knowing, you glorify Him every second of your existence. Mm-hmm. If I stop glorifying his name is because something happened to me. See, only it takes 5 minutes for a person not saying the name of the girl, he can turn green, blue, yellow, or purple, but it's dead. He had to continuously repeat the name of the creator. Otherwise, gone. This is the time you stop, the body stop saying the name of the creator, gone. Now, Yahweh, nobody see the Father. Yahweh is pure spirit.
That's right.
You find the Bible, nobody see the Father at any time. Why? Because Yahweh we only know him, knowing the existence of these principal attributes, 9 principal attributes. They're not physical.
That's right.
Are invisible, but they exist, and they exist in us, and all of us, and every man. Remember, Yahweh, he chose a cloud to symbolize himself. Yahweh is not a cloud. But he picked up a cloud to symbolize himself. Mm-hmm. Because the cloud don't have any particular shape or form. Now this cloud, by transmutation, mm-hmm. taking a shape and form of a man without flesh and blood. This only is being seen in a vision and a revelation. And it's Elohim. Elohim is the only divine title of Yahweh in a shape mm-hmm. and form of a man. Now, this transmutation, Yahweh by transmutation became Elohim, and he is the Father of the physical and the spiritual. But it's Yahweh Elohim. It's the same. It's not 2 different persons. Yahweh Elohim and the Holy Spirit. 1, 2, 3. How simple is this? Everything is made according to the pattern of the tabernacle. Mm-hmm. 1, 2, 3. Cells and atom. 1, 2, 3. Proton, neutron, electron. Nucleus, nucleolus, and cell body. 1, 2, 3. Mm-hmm. Air, water, and earth. 1, 2, 3. And look at this simple thing. Looks simple, but have something spiritual meaning. Some spiritual meaning. This is the sun. It's a figure of sun. Mercury, Venus, and Earth. Martian. In this planet, there is water. It's distant from the sun, 3 planets. Not in the first, not in the second, in the third. Mm-hmm. And the third, in this world, there is life. Mm-hmm. And Yahweh is life. We are distant from the sun, 3 planets. The moon, We have the moon. I've been observing this thing. You know, I like to paint, and I make a mistake painting. But let me mention something I found here a while ago. This moon is backwards. This is the sun, supposed to reflect the light and the moon. According to this picture, this is a dark place, and the light is here. Let me paint it this way. If this is a moon, we're supposed to have the light in here, and this is a dark place. The moon have light, but not for its own. The moon have light because the sun gave it to. This is why Lucifer, or we call the mystery of iniquity, have lot of power because the sun gave him the power for his purpose. For his purpose. This is why the moon, most of the time we can see her in the night. Because she is the queen of the dark, of the night. I don't know why I'm going this way, but those are the things I've been learning, investigate, and I keep try to find as our first aim. The first aim is to help you find and know Yahweh, if He really is and actually exists. If we open our eyes, we can find Yahweh in anything.
That's right.
We're looking into. Geography, medicine, botanic, oceanography, volcanology, astrology, anywhere, any science, and every physical item also. Every object you're looking into, Yahweh is there. Well, it's a very good pleasure to find someone to listen. Somebody want to listen what Yahweh gave me. I just try to give it away. With all those things, I say thank you very much.
Hello. Our next speaker would be Dr. Joe Williams.
Good evening, class. I enjoy that. There are a couple of things I want to draw out that I think would be significant in the short time I have. I was going to go another direction tonight, but he says something I feel like it might be more appropriate. Now, pick up Philippians 4:22. And why you got Philippians 4:22? Why don't you also pick up, well, we'll just wait. 1 Corinthians 15:1. Now, what was significant is when you're talking about the moon, and he's talking about David. And what he said about David, David chose pestilence rather than 7 years of no water. He chose pestilence for the 3 years of...
3 months.
3 months of...
chasing him. They tried to kill him.
Yeah. But he chose the 3 days. Now, when David chose 3 days, it brought out that 70,000 lost their lives. And simply because David did not want to make a sacrifice. David was being selfish. And I'm going to tell you why David was being selfish. Because he didn't receive the double portion. The Holy Spirit had not yet been poured out as of yet. And what he was looking at was 3 days versus 7 years versus 3 months. What he didn't know was the sacrifice. And see, by him being ignorant of Yahweh's grace, he ended up sacrificing 70,000 people's lives. Mm-hmm. You see? Now, when he did that, I'm telling you without any hesitation, there was no love in David's heart. Somebody said, what are you talking about? Why? Because the Holy Spirit or Pentecost had not yet come. There was nothing in him to love with. He was looking at himself. He didn't know that 70,000 was going to be sacrificed. He didn't know that. It's not like folks weren't dying. But the fact, when you got a king, and you're going to sacrifice your flock, they're not going to say something about you. And I'm telling you is that David was steeped in darkness. Israel was ruled by the moon, by darkness. Now, I want to compare him to the Apostle Paul. Alright? Now, here comes the Apostle Paul. Alright? Now remember, there's so much. Read Philippians. I'm going to set this thing up. I think I can do this.
Philippians 4 and 20.
Now listen, this is the Apostle Paul. After the death, the burial, and the resurrection, and the outpouring of the Holy Spirit. Mm-hmm. And let me say something else about Paul. You see, Paul knew about the resurrection of Yahshua the Messiah, but he didn't believe. Folks told him that Yahshua's going to die. He even told them he's going to die, bury, and resurrect. But they said crucify him. Mm-hmm. As far as Paul was concerned, he was dead and gone. You see? And his mission and his duty, and he received permission from council to go out and to bound those Jews or those Hebrews that was holding on or who have embraced Yahshua Messiah. Death, his burial, and his resurrection, and preaching the death, burial, and resurrection of Yahshua Messiah. That's what he did, talking about the Apostle Paul. You see? That was after, you see, the Messiah's resurrection. Now, you watch. This is what Paul says after he received the gift of the Holy Spirit. You see? This is what he says. Read on.
Philippians 4 and 22.
Come on.
All the sons salute you.
Read on.
Chiefly they that are of Caesar's household.
Is that what I want? That Philippians 4 and 22?
It is.
Read on down. Keep reading.
The grace of our Savior, Yahshua the Messiah, be with you all. That's the end of it.
Then it's Ephesians 4:22. Okay. I apologize. That's it. I said Philippians. We're only going to go to Philippians. I'm only going to Philippians 3:20 because of what Samuel said. We ain't going to read it. It says our conversation is in heaven. And that's why that young man could receive what Samuel said. Because, you see, he was caught up and steeped in that darkness because of disbelief. Only thing he knows is that which has been, that's been, I would say like this, conceived in darkness and ignorance. And that is the flesh. That's all, and that's all this is. He's holding on to the flesh. Talking about that young man. But when he first heard it, he was enlightened. But when he went and talked to his brother, whoever, he came back. He didn't want to hear. Is it because of what he's embraced in his heart and mind? Let's read, please.
Ephesians 4:22. That ye put off your former behavior, the old man, which is corrupt according to the deceitful lust.
Now look, the old man is corrupt because of his deceitful lust. Now the conditions are the same, you see, with us today as they were when the Apostle Paul had not believed, and same as when David had not believed. The conditions are the same. He didn't know Yahshua, Messiah. Let's read, please.
And be renewed in the spirit of your mind.
But you must be renewed in the spirit of your mind. That had not yet happened to David. Not at that particular time. However, the resurrection had come, you see, and was still going on when the Apostle Paul was running around, you see, persecuting the city of Joshua Messiah. Otherwise, he would not have been consenting to the stoning of Stephen. You with me so far? Because at that particular time, he had not yet received the gift of the Holy Spirit. But you got to be renewed in your mind. Read on.
And that ye put on the new man.
That you got to put on the new man. Read on.
Which after Elohim is created.
Read on.
In righteousness and true holiness.
In other words, the Holy Spirit must be formed in you. These attributes of intelligence, wisdom, knowledge, beauty, love, justice, voluntary, power, strength, they must be formed in you. You see, in order for you to see the reality of this teaching, or to see who you are, or to come to a profound understanding of Yahweh's divine purpose and his pattern and his plan. And that is, these attributes must be formed. Look, they're already there, but you have to recognize who they are. They have to become conscious, and you have to utilize them, just as Paul did. All right? Read on a little bit more. Read.
Wherefore,
read,
putting away lying,
read on,
speak every man truth with his neighbor.
Read on.
For we are members one of another.
That's good enough. You see, that's what Paul said. You got to be renewed in the spirit of your mind. That was after he received the gift of the Holy Spirit. You see? Now, this is something else Paul said. 1 Corinthians 15:1. Now he wrote this letter to the Corinthians. And he said, let no divisions be among you. You see? But moreover, brethren, read please.
Moreover, brethren.
Read.
I declare unto you the gospel which I preached unto you.
Now Paul is declaring the death, the burial, the resurrection, and the ascension of the Holy Spirit. On the outpouring of the Holy Spirit. You see? After the day of Pentecost. Read please.
Which also ye have received, and wherein ye stand.
Read on.
By which also ye are saved.
Read on.
If ye keep in memory what I preached unto you, unless ye have believed in vain.
That's what happened to Samuel. He preached to that guy. Sounds good. Was made a commitment, but fell short because his belief was in vain. It's just a waste of time. He listened. He thought it was good, but he didn't hold on, he didn't keep it in memory. You see? Let's read, please.
For I delivered unto you first of all that which I also received.
Read on.
How that Yahshua died for our sins according to the scriptures.
Read on.
And that he was buried.
Read.
And that he was that he rose again.
Read on.
That day according to the scriptures.
Read on.
And that he was seen
read.
By Judas.
Read.
Then by the 11.
Read on.
After that he was
so seen. Now he's letting you know what happened. You follow me? When he received this gift and how it affected him. Read, please.
After that, he was seen by more than 500 brethren.
Read on. Read.
Whom the greater part remained until this present day.
Now he's talking about the day of Pentecost, okay? Let's read. Come on.
Some are falling asleep.
Read.
After that, he was seen by James.
Read.
Then by all the apostles.
Read on.
And last of all, he was seen by me
now,
also.
Now, Paul said, now last of all, he was seen by me. We ain't going to get that, but you guys know about the story that he was on his way to Damascus. Right.
It's conversion.
Right? And he was knocked off his donkey right after he was consenting to the stoning of Stephen. You see, I might get that maybe. Keep reading, please.
And at last of all, he was seen by me also.
Read on.
As of one born out of due time.
That is, I was one born out of due time. In other words, I wasn't a part of the 12 that walked around with the Messiah on the Palestine Judean hills. I was one born out of due time. But read on, please.
For I am least of the
apostles. I am the least of the apostles. I'm not worthy to be one. One, I'm persecuting the city of Yahshua the Messiah. I ain't even, I haven't earned a right to be an apostle. Because of my deportment. My disposition. Because I want to hold on to the law of sin and death. Because of how I was raised. The image. What was presented to me. Let's read, please. Come on.
For I'm the least of apostles, that I am not fit to be called an apostle.
And now he said it as well. Come on.
Because I persecuted the assembly of
Israel. Come on.
But by the grace of Yahweh, I am what I am, and his grace which was bestowed upon me.
In other words, so be it, I couldn't help it. It wasn't my fault. I just didn't know. I was ignorant. Come on, read, please.
But I labor more abundantly.
But I work. I was what Zaius and all of them, including Judas and Peter. I was Zaius more than all of them. Read, please.
Yet not I, but the grace of Yahweh.
Oh, yet not I. Not Paul. No, not Paul. But the grace which are these attributes have been formed in me. Come on, read.
Therefore, whether it were I or they,
read.
So we preach, and so ye believe.
That's good enough right there. You see, that's what Paul said. It was the grace of Yahweh. Go just read on a little bit more. One more thing I want to bring out about that.
Now, if the Messiah be preached.
Oh, that's enough, because I want to go on to something else. But it was the grace, these attributes that was activated in the Apostle Paul. Causing Paul to die off and to grow in Yahshua Messiah. You see? Now this is something else Paul said. Philippians 3 and 5. And pick up Acts. The 21st chapter and hold the 8th verse until I get there. I think that's what I want. Now look, Paul says, I was more zealous than all of them. You see? And then he's going to tell you why. You might want to back up a few more verses before 3 and 5 and back up a little bit to maybe the second or the third verse.
For we are of the circumcision.
That's good enough. Is that one? Just start at one. It ain't going to take but a second to read that down.
Philippians 3 and 1.
Read.
Finally, my brethren.
Read.
Rejoice in Yahweh.
Read.
To write the same things to you. To me, indeed, is not grievous, but for you it is safe.
Read on.
Beware of dogs. Beware of evil workers. Beware of the concision.
Uh-huh.
For we are the circumcision which worship Yahweh in the Spirit.
Uh-huh.
And rejoice in Yahshua the Messiah.
Read.
And have no confidence in the flesh.
In other words, we ain't got no confidence in our egotistical, misdirected personality. That is the flesh.
Mm-hmm.
We ain't got no confidence in that. We ain't got no confidence.
confidence in the law. This law was imposed upon us. There's no flesh that can keep that law, but some folks think they can. You see? But we ain't got no confidence in that. And the only reason we hold on to that, you know what? Because there ain't no spirit that's poured out. The Holy Spirit has not been formed within us. We do not believe the report. Let's read, please.
Though I might also have confidence in the flesh.
Read on.
If any other man thinketh that he hath whereof he might trust in the flesh, I more.
In other words, Paul said, look, if anybody should be trusting in the flesh, it should be me. I live this law. I consented to the stoning of Stephen. I was there when the Messiah got crucified. If anybody should be me, read please.
Circumcised the 8th day.
Circumcised the 8th day like any other Jew, a real Hebrew. Read on.
Of the stock of Israel.
And guess what? I'm from the stock of who? Benjamin. And let me tell you something.
The tribe of Benjamin, yeah.
And Benjaminites, they can fight. I mean, they can fight. You hear what I'm saying? But let's read, please.
A Hebrew of the Hebrew.
A Hebrew of the Hebrew. If anybody should believe in the flesh, it should be me. From a natural physical standpoint, I have been circumcised the 8th day. I am from the seed of Abraham. If anybody should believe in the flesh, it should be me. Read, please.
As touching the law.
Read.
A Pharisee.
Read on.
Concerning zeal.
Read.
Persecuting the assembly.
Uh-huh.
Touching the righteousness.
Read on.
Which is in the law.
Read.
Blameless.
Read.
But what things were gained to me that I counted loss for the Messiah.
Now this is what I did. But thanks be to Yahweh. That through his son, Yahshua Messiah, I was made to believe the report. You see? That's what it said. And listen, not only that, Acts. I know I caught another scripture.
21:8.
Hold that. But Acts 22:1. You see? This is how sharp Paul was. Read, please.
Men, brethren, and fathers.
Read.
Hear ye my defense, which I make now unto you.
Read on.
And when they heard that, he spake in the Hebrew tongue to them.
Now listen, this is after Paul was on his way to Damascus, got knocked out on his donkey, and then, you see, there was a gentleman that by way of a vision, Ananias was told to take Paul in to his house. And Ananias said, look, this man is crazy. He's running around killing all the silly Yahshua Messiah. What am I going to be doing letting him up in the house? But the Holy Spirit said, just do what I say and be obedient and let him in. You follow what I'm saying? Oh, there's so much. I just can't pass this up. Go ahead, read that and I'll pick up. And then somebody hold Acts I believe it's the eighth chapter. Read on, please. Read on.
They kept more silence, and he said,
read.
I am verily a man which am a Jew.
Read on.
Born in Tarsus.
Read on.
City in Cilicia.
This is Paul giving his resume. You understand? Let you know what kind of Jew I am. Come on.
He was brought up in this city at the feet of Gamaliel.
I was brought up at the feet, what? At Gamaliel. No, he was taught. He was tutored. His father paid to have his son learn the law. You see, Pharisee, Hebrews of Hebrews, from the stock of Benjamin. You see? So Paul wasn't know any old body. Read, please.
And taught according to the perfect manner of the law of
read.
The Father.
So it's not like he didn't know the law. So he knew it so well, you know what? He's really kill anybody who was opposing the law. But what Paul did not understand, he was opposing Yahweh. But he thought he did it, he did it with a sincere heart. He was not being deceitful. His intent was not to hurt anybody. His intent was to hold on to what Yahweh showed him or what was imposed upon him. As far as he was concerned, Yahshua Messiah was just Joseph's and Mary's boy. That's how he felt. Alright, that's good enough right there. Let's pick up Acts the 8th chapter because I'm pushed for time. Read, please.
Acts 18 and 1.
Read on.
Eight.
I think it's 8. This is where he's talking to. This is where he gets knocked off the donkey.
And Saul was consenting unto his death.
Read on.
And at that time there was great persecution against the congregation.
Read on.
Which was at Jerusalem.
Read on.
And they were all scattered abroad throughout the regions of Judea and Samaria, except the apostles.
Read on.
And devout men carried Stephen to his burial and made great lamentations over him. As for Saul, he made havoc of the congregation, entering into every house and hailing men and women, committed them to prison.
Mm-hmm.
Therefore,
that's good enough right there. Now jump over to 9:1, because I want to make the point there. Read on.
Acts 9:1.
Uh-huh.
And Saul, yet breathing out threatenings and slaughter against the disciples
of
Joshua, went unto the high priest.
Read.
And desired of him letters to Damascus to the synagogue.
Come on.
That if he found any of this way, whether they were men or women,
read,
he might bring them bound unto Jerusalem.
Now keep in mind, folks, we're talking about Paul's conscience or state and condition before he received the Holy Spirit, or before he became conscious, and the same conditions after he received it. Same condition, same thing, same conditions he's in, or the same as what we are in. Read, please.
And as he journeyed, he came near Damascus.
Read on.
And suddenly there shined round about him a light from heaven.
Now here comes the vision. Read on.
And he fell to the earth,
mm-hmm,
and heard a voice saying unto him.
Read on.
Saul, Saul, why persecutest thou?
Now here's the Messiah talking to him. Read on. In his consciousness. Read on. And in other words, he's piercing the veil of the flesh. Mm-hmm. Not his physical body, but that veil of the flesh. That caused him not to believe in Yahshua the Messiah or the assembly of Yahshua the Messiah. Somebody pick up Isaiah 42:16 and hold it. Read, please.
And he said,
read.
Who art thou, sir?
In other words, read on. In other words, I don't know what this voice coming up. You ain't getting it. Read, please.
And Yahshua said,
read.
I am Yahshua of Nazareth.
Now, you know he was too fit to be tied at that point. He couldn't believe it. You see? Read, please.
Mm-hmm. Whom thou persecutest.
Read.
It is hard
for now, wait a minute. Hold it now. You was there, Paul. I mean, come on now. You ain't going to get out of this one. Mm-hmm. You were there. Mm-hmm. Read, please.
It is hard for thee to kick against the pricks.
Come on.
And he, trembling and astonished, said,
wait a minute. He was scared. Mm-hmm. Yeah. You follow what I'm saying?
Yeah.
There was witnesses.
Yeah.
The light shine and his posse, they heard the voice, but they didn't see. Mm-hmm. But they heard the voice. Come on.
Yahshua, what wilt thou have me to do?
And listen, humbly. Mm-hmm. I mean, he humbled himself. What will you have me to do? Mm-hmm. I didn't know. Read the power of the resurrection. But because he was a Pharisee, he believed in the resurrection. Had that been a Sadducee, I don't know what the heck would have happened. But see, a Pharisee, they believe in the resurrection. So now he's talking to Paul. Is he? Read, please.
And Yahshua said unto him,
read.
Arise and go into the city.
Read.
And it shall be told thee what thou must do.
Read on.
And the men which journeyed with him stood speechless.
Read on.
Hearing a voice, but seeing no man.
So when Paul went to tell the story later on, they knew he wouldn't lie because he had witnesses. They didn't see nothing, but they heard the voice. Because Yahweh does absolutely nothing without witnesses, all right? Mm-hmm. Let's read, please.
And Saul arose from the earth.
Read.
And when his eyes were opened,
read.
He saw no man.
Uh-oh. Read on.
But they led him by the hand.
Read.
And brought him into Damascus.
Read on.
And he was 3 days without sight.
Oh, man. It was 3 days like being in a tomb. He was immersed. Because see, Paul had to die. But he was immersed in that darkness. Read on, please.
And neither did eat nor drink.
Read on.
And there was a certain...
Gotta be a sacrifice. You know what I mean? Mm-hmm. Gotta be a sacrifice. Come on, read, please. Now, with David, there was no sacrifice. Because he was scared, too. Mm-hmm. How many men are there? How many men are there? I mean, we got to witness what? We got to witness fight. And Yahweh said he didn't forget. He knew what the law was. Mm-hmm. That's why he got punished. Is it? Read, please.
And there was a certain disciple at Damascus,
read,
named Ananias.
Now he said a certain disciple, he said a certain apostle. In other words, the apostles walked with the Messiah, but the disciples, they believed in Messiah.
Mm-hmm. Right.
You see? Let's read, please.
And Yahshua said unto him,
read,
in a vision,
uh-huh,
Ananias.
Now here's Yahshua, Got to have a witness. Talking to Ananias. Read on, please.
And he said, Behold, I am here, sir.
Read.
And Yahshua said unto him,
Come on.
Arise and go into the street which is called Straight.
Read on.
And inquire in the house of Judah for one called Saul of Tarsus.
Read on.
For behold, he prayeth and hath seen a vision in a man named Ananias coming in and putting his hand on him that he might receive.
Now see how Yahweh's working this thing? He got one, you see, who received the Holy Spirit, which is Ananias, and he talking to him. We got one who is trying to cultivate, you know, he's going to use him to cultivate and to nurture Paul, you see, who has not become conscious of who he is yet. But the Holy Spirit is dealing with him, you see, because of the state condition he was in, which is like us, which is our egotistical, misdirected personality, if you will. This composite man here. You see? Read, please.
That he might receive his sight.
That he might receive his sight. Now hold it. Isaiah 42, 16.
Isaiah 42, 16.
Now we know that what's ever written in the law is confirmed by the prophets, right?
Right.
You see? And whatever is written in prophecy is going to prophesy about the Messiah's, you see, fulfilling something. Is that correct? It's just prophecy. Now let's read.
And I will bring the blind by a way that they do not.
Now, is Paul not blind or not? Of course he is. That's why he's up in Ananias' house. Come on, let's read.
I will lead them in paths that they have not known.
Now, you know Paul ain't never been blind before. You see, read. I'm talking about physically so. You see, the blindness and the dirt is pointing to the state of his mind. The state of his consciousness, the conditions he in. In darkness, read on, please.
I will make darkness light before.
I will make darkness what?
Light before them.
In other words, you gotta see something, because you know whenever there is darkness, you see, it don't care if it's a tiny match, it's gonna dispel that darkness. Mm-hmm. That light is gonna dispel that darkness.
That's right.
And my light, if I was there, or my match, or my candle, can light your candle, your candle, your candle. Just the one, don't need more. Light everybody's candle. You see? So here, God's Messiah, who is that light? You follow me? He's talking to Ananias, and what he's not going to do, he's nurturing Paul while he's in that darkness. Let's read, please.
And crooked things straight.
And he's going to do what?
He will make darkness light before them and crooked things
straight. And crooked things straight. You see? And listen, now Paul was on a crooked path. You see? And there's a street called what?
Straight.
You see? He's going to make crooked things straight. Now he's going to straighten Paul out right now. Mm-hmm. You see? And through, you see, Yahweh's death, burial, resurrection, sent out of the Holy Spirit, now he's illuminating Paul's consciousness, who's going to now turn to the Gentiles to make crooked things straight or to illuminate their consciousness. Mm-hmm. You see? Let's read, please.
These things will I do unto them.
Read on.
Not forsake them.
That's good enough. You see? Now, head on back over there, and where Paul is still in darkness, and his eyes open up. And still hold on to Acts, you see, 21 and 8. Let's read.
Acts 21 and
8? Not yet.
So,
where we left off in Acts, the 9th chapter. Let's read.
Right, okay. That he might receive his sight. Then Ananias answered, Sir, I have heard by many of this man how much evil he hath done to thy sons
in
Jerusalem.
Now what Paul, Ananias is looking at the facts. He's looking at what the heck happened to Stephen. Mm-hmm. And ain't seen yet what's going to happen to James and Peter, but he's looking at definitely what's happening with Stephen. Let's read, please.
And here he hath authority from the chief priests to bind all.
In other words, here Ananias is questioning the Messiah. Do you know who we're dealing with here? And he's going to make the chief priests greater than the Messiah. Because he don't know, this is a new experience for him. You see? Let's read, please.
To bind all that call on thy name.
Read on.
But Yahshua said unto
him. Now listen. I remember. I died willingly. I got buried in Joseph's new tomb. And when they come looking for me, I wasn't there. I resurrected. Be of good cheer. And just believe and be obedient. Do exactly what I tell you to do. Let's read, please.
Go thy way.
Read.
For he is a chosen vessel unto me.
Read on.
To bear my name before nations.
Read.
Kings and the children of Israel.
Come on, read on.
For I will show him how great things he must suffer for my name's sake.
Read on.
And Ananias went his way and entered into the house, and putting his hands on him, said, Brother Saul, Yahshua,
read on.
That appeared unto thee in the way as thou camest, hath sent me, that thou mayest receive thy sight and be filled with the Holy Spirit.
Come on.
And immediately it was as though scales had fallen from his eyes, and he received sight forthwith and rose and was immersed.
Now he resurrected out of that darkness. Mm-hmm. All right? And then he ate for a few more days. You follow me? And he moved on. He was obedient. Mm-hmm. Acts. I got time. Let's start. At Acts, I think I want. Pick this back up maybe to about four. See, what happened was this. Yeah. I think it's four. See, what happened, Paul was, look, he made a journey. And as he was making his journeys, you see, here's Paul. You see, here's Paul's journey. Here he is right here. In Damascus. You follow me? Joppa. Moving on around. You follow me? You follow me? He's hanging on out. You see? And it was Paul who went to Rome. Not Peter.
Right.
All right? But he went talking to all the Gentiles. He's just moving around. You follow what I'm saying? Moving around, talking to the Gentiles. There he is. Mm-hmm. Talking to those Gentiles. There he is. That's Saul. You understand what I'm saying? Now, he ain't not yet made it to Jerusalem yet. Because they heard about him. They don't want Paul to go to Jerusalem. Because they say they're going to kill you up there. Mm-hmm. They're going to kill you. Don't go to Jerusalem. Read it one. Start one. It's going to take a second. Read on down.
From 4 and 1.
21 and 1.
21 and 1.
Yeah.
Okay.
And I'll skip down quickly.
And it came to pass that after we were gotten from them and had lunch, we came with a straight course unto Goose.
Read on.
And the day following unto Rhodes.
Read on.
And from thence unto Patara.
Mm-hmm.
And finding a ship sailing over unto Phoenicia.
Read on, please.
We went abroad and set forth. Now when we had sighted Cyprus, we left it on the left hand.
Read on.
And sailed into Syria.
Come on.
And landed at Tyre.
Read.
For there the ship was to unload her cargo.
Come on.
And finding disciples.
Read.
We tarried there 7 days.
Come on.
Said,
read.
Saul, through the Spirit, that he should not go up to Jerusalem.
Read. Now they don't want him to go there. Read.
And when he had accomplished those days,
read.
He departed and went our way.
After 7 days, come on.
And they all brought us on our way.
Read.
With wives and children.
Read on.
Till we were out of the city.
Read.
And we kneeled down on the shore and prayed.
Read on.
And when we had taken our leave
of
one another, we took ship.
Read.
And they returned home again.
Come on.
And when we had finished our course from Tyre,
read.
We came to
Ptolemais
and saluted the brethren in a bowl. With them one day.
Preach it! Read, please!
And the next day we that were of Saul's company departed and came to Caesarea.
Mm-hmm.
And we entered into the house of Philip.
Read.
The evangelist.
Read.
Which was one of the seven and abode with him.
Come on!
And the same man had four daughters, virgins which did prophecy.
Read.
And as we tarried there many days, they came down from Judea.
Read.
A certain prophet named Agabus.
Uh-huh. Now listen, this is what he said. Read.
And when he was come unto us,
read.
He took Saul's girdle and read. Bound his hand.
Now when he came, he goes Paul. And he takes his girdle off, right? Read, please.
And bound his own hand.
And then he bound himself up, right? Read on.
Thus saith the Holy Spirit.
Read.
So shall the Jews at Jerusalem bind the man that owneth this girdle.
Read on.
Shall deliver him into the hands of the heathen.
Now he's telling, look, man, you poor guy, you gonna get fooling the folks from Jerusalem. Read, please.
And when he had heard these things,
read.
Both we and they of that place besought him not to go up to Jerusalem.
Read, please.
Then Saul answered.
Now this is what Paul said. Now this is the difference between Paul or Saul and David. Read.
What mean you to weep and to break mine heart?
We don't know. Why you act like this? Oh, ye of little faith. Read.
For I am ready not to be bound only.
Hey, listen, not only am I ready to be bound, read on.
But also to die.
But I'm going to die for this teaching. Mm-hmm. That's the power of Yahweh.
Yeah.
I'm going to sacrifice myself. Mm-hmm. Not you, but for me, so that you might be saved.
Mm-hmm.
but also to die at Jerusalem for the name of Yahshua the Messiah.
What other reason? He gonna die for the name of a Sicili? No! He gonna die for the name of Yahshua Messiah. That's what it's all about, folks.
Yes.
That's what Paul did. You see, they did not know who Yahshua Messiah was. The power had not been poured out. You see, nevertheless, David was numbered with the sons. You see, as Yahshua resurrected, being the first fruits, David was a part of that number. Because David was from the line tribe of Judah. You see, where was the kingship tribe. You see? And so let me tell you this here. It was David who stood up and fought Goliath.
Right.
Wasn't David. It was the Messiah in him that did that. Mm-hmm. You see? Because at that time, and I'm going to sit down, the veils will be raised and the curtain will come down. Mm-hmm. The way we used to say it, some folks still say it, that the Holy Spirit would hop in a man, hop out of a man. Don't operate like that.
Yeah.
The veil is raised, and the veil is also let down. Mm-hmm. You know, I could say more to that, but I'm going to hold it right there, and I hope and trust you guys got something I would say today. Hallelujah.
Yeah.
Father, truly thank the Father for allowing the whole class this evening.
Yeah. An announcement. This Sunday will be the so-called grand reopening of the Pomona class after all the new paint job and the carpeting and everything has been put in. And we are, of course, invited to attend this event.
Who invited us?
Vicki.
Who?
Vicki Martin Hunt.
When?
Today.
Maybe she was here.
Maybe yesterday. Yesterday.
She was here at class Tuesday. And
right.
She didn't say nothing about that.
Well, maybe it wasn't. Maybe it wasn't okay. Finalized. And I'm just saying, be a nice touch.
Huh?
It could have been an afterthought. It could have been an afterthought on her part. Mm-hmm. I didn't know anything about it either.
Okay, we hold classes every Tuesday and Friday from 7:30 to 9:30 Sunday mornings. From 11 to 1, and the last Sunday of every month, we have a Mexican class from Spanish class from 9:30 to 10:30. 9:30 to 10:30. So come back again and study with us. Bring your friends and all your enemies, and all donations will be accepted by our treasurer, Irene Ramirez, and stand for the doxology. Now unto him that is able to keep you from falling and present you faultless before the presence of his glory with exceeding joy, to the only wise Elohim, our Savior, through Yahshua the Messiah, our Sovereign, belong glory, majesty, dominion, and power, both before all time, now and ever. Let us all say.
Hallelujah.
You did a good job. You set me up. I don't talk about something else.
Okay.
Something to tell somebody that on Friday.
Yeah, we had her since a little pup.
It's a girl.